My name is Dave. We are at Anandagaur Master Unit in Denmark. We are here for the 2014 Prout Conference. With me, I have Dada Maheshvarananda, who works in Venezuela with a Prout project, and he will tell us a little bit about his experience in Venezuela and about his project.
Dada?
Thank you. In 1998, Hugo Chavez was elected president of the country. It was a total political upset. He changed the controlling political parties who had traditionally controlled the country for a long time. And for the first time, he mobilized the poor people to create a political force, a majority, to change the country. And for the first time after that, he started using petroleum, the income from petroleum sales that Venezuela gets, for everyone. He made a little logo, very small, three little stick characters, different colors holding hands, and the slogan goes, Venezuela ahora es de todos, meaning Venezuela for the first time now is for everyone. I found that very significant. I've worked with poor people around the world for about 37 years. And frankly, any country, any government that is doing things for the poor people has my respect. So one of the first things he started doing was making free health care for everyone. He opened clinics. He traded petroleum for Cuban doctors. There's now about 30,000 Cuban doctors, dentists, medical technicians, some agronomists, even some sports coaches who are working in Venezuela. They all speak perfect Spanish. They're very competently qualified according to the World Health Organization. And so he built clinics in all the poorest barrios of the country and in all the poorest villages. So for example, Petare is a slum that's right near our house at the easternmost part of Caracas. It's a very large slum. There's about 1.6 million inhabitants. And the medical in charge for the state explained to me that when Chavez came to power, there were four medical clinics for this 1.6 million people in the slum. After Chavez came, there are today four hospitals and 127 clinics in that same area. So you don't have to walk more than three or four blocks to get to the next medical clinic, where there's a doctor on call, and you know, every medical emergency is taken care of. So this saves lives. I spoke with other poor women in the hills of Vargas, near Caracas, and they said, you know, we were so poor before, campesinos in this poor place, we were so poor that when somebody got sick, they often died. It took us 2 days to carry the body down to the cemetery. And by the time we got back, there was sometimes another body waiting to go. That's how bad it was. Today, we have a clinic in our village and every village around here. Nobody dies for lack of medical care. And you see all these fields around us, she pointed out? These are cultivated because we got loans from the Ban Mujer, the Women's Bank, government bank. They gave us loans, we formed cooperatives, and now we have enough income from the sale of this to pay for our transport. We can transport this to the local markets, and we have an income for the first time in our lives. So we're never going back, she said. We're never going back to the way things were before. Education. He did tremendous work with education. The number of students enrolled in universities now is double to what it was before. There are free universities in addition to the state universities. You know, one thing, Dave, I can't translate is what student loans are. In the United States, students have loans up to you know, $20,000, $100,000 more at the end of their 4 years of university studies, and they don't have that in Venezuela. So that's impressive. More than 1 million kids who were out of school because there weren't enough schools or there weren't enough teachers, they're now in school. So it's an impressive, all school-age kids are in school. Literacy has basically been eradicated. It's down to zero or almost zero. They've done really good work with education, really good work with health.
All these changes, have they changed at all? Have they gone back at all after Chavez passed away?
Oh no. The social programs, the missions, and there are a lot of missions. Food, for example, there's free kitchens there in the poor barrios. There are subsidized food stores everywhere. No, the social programs are very much underway. And I can also say even the opposition, who hate Chavez, who hate the present government, they too are wise enough to say if they come to power, they will not close down the missions because these are very popular missions. So, no, the social programs are going to continue. The economy is cooperatives. He started a lot of cooperatives.
This is a very interesting thing. Do you think if Venezuela goes ahead keeping a certain level of social security, social service,
right,
that it's going to be the culture to demand it forever and on, like in Scandinavia?
Yes. Oh, yes. And the poor people who were always silenced, who were always excluded, will never be silenced again.
Hmm.
Now, they may vote for the opposition. They may decide that because of certain inefficiencies, because of certain problems, they're going to vote for the other party. But they won't be silenced again, and they won't let their social network be broken. So there's been a lot of political consciousness raising. So for example, economic democracy, which we support, is saying we need an economy of the people, by the people, and for the people. And political awareness and political voice. So for example, there are now 33,000 communal councils. This is a group of 400 families, and they have regular meetings where they work by consensus, and they list all the problems of their small community. They list them all down, and then they prioritize them and decide which are the first, they want the park cleaned up, they want the road fixed, the school needs improvements in the school. They list all the problems.
Seems like a great improvement on most Western democracies.
It is. It's participatory democracy is what it is. And Venezuelans know that, and they know what's going on. So they decide the priorities. They fix the number one, number two priorities. They decide together. And then they make a project proposal for that. Not much, $10,000 to $20,000. They make the application to the central government, and the federal government generally always approves it. It goes to the Communal Council Cooperative Bank, and they use that money to solve the problem that they chose. So it's not a case where the central government is telling them what to do. The people themselves are empowered to decide for themselves what they want to do. They can't do everything, but with that amount of money, they can do this much, or they can do this, or they can do that. So that's empowering. He also started many cooperatives, too many in fact, I'll explain that. Because cooperatives need people need to know each other, they need to work together, they need to have a strategy, and they actually build on their strengths to be a successful cooperative. And in fact, in the job training program starting in 2003, after the 2002, there was a coup d'etat against Chavez. It's certainly the United States government knew about it and supported the planners. But that failed, and Chavez, 48 hours later, was brought back by the people and by the military who supported him. he came back to power, he decided to become more radical. And he started promoting much more socialism for the 21st century. He didn't want the socialism from the past, he wanted something new. And but socialism means that the resources are for everyone. All his programs were to alleviate poverty, and they're doing a good job of that, actually. So a lot of cooperatives were started. They're today the best estimates from Gestión Participativa, an NGO that really focuses on cooperatives and cooperative training. They're the best estimates are 90,000 functioning cooperatives, which is the highest number in the world outside of China. Most of these cooperatives are small, 5 members or more. That's all you need legally. And most of them, the majority, are low education cooperatives, meaning car mechanics, a restaurant, bus drivers, taxi drivers.
What is the situation, let's say, if you're a small private trader, small private shop owner?
Right.
Do they have a scope to exist and thrive?
Oh, yes. Yes. Large business people are, they have the greatest complaints. Because of petroleum, they have traditionally, the country traditionally has had what is called the Dutch disease, meaning agriculture goes down when there's a lot of money in the country, manufacturing goes down and services go up. So you get and a lot of imports, a lot of importations of what people need. So you have that historically in Venezuela since the 1930s. Unfortunately, because of the monetary policies of the socialist government, it's very hard to get imports now. It's hard to get dollars. They have three official exchange rates and a fourth unofficial exchange
rate. Is that an attempt to stop imports to save local industries?
It's an attempt to stop the flight of capital, because in many third world countries, the rich people take their money in suitcases to the United States or Europe and invest it there. So the money is constantly fleeing the country. So these controls have greatly reduced that flight of capital. Unfortunately, they've also made importations very hard, and some of the policies, Marxist policies of price controls, means that right now in these last 6-8 months, there's been a lot of shortages.
A few years ago, they demanded their gold back from London.
Yes.
Or was it New York? One of the two.
From overseas, yes.
Yeah.
And they brought it back.
Why don't they just back their currency with gold and tell people you cannot get the gold unless you ask for it in Venezuela?
It's an interesting proposal. I'm not an economist, so I can't really speak.
Well, you should suggest it to them when you go back to Venezuela.
Right, I'll do that, Dave, I promise. Anyway, so like that, there are shortages, but there's no hunger. And that's a very significant difference. I mean, we sometimes have to go 1, 2, 3, 4 supermarkets to find what we're looking for. But that's not the same as hunger. There's no hunger in the country. Okay, so cooperatives,
so what is your work in Venezuela?
I went there, first of all, in 2003, I produced my first Prout book, and it was published in 10 languages, including Spanish.
What's the name of the book?
It was called After Capitalism, Prout's Vision for a New World. And that time, I was able to present a copy to the president, Hugo Chavez, on his national television show. He had a weekly show. Lasted 5 hours. I got about 90 seconds. It wasn't a big deal, right? But yes, I was able to present it personally to him before the show. And in those 90 seconds, it was interesting because he said, he saw that the preface was by Noam Chomsky. He said, we like Noam Chomsky. He saw Frei Beto's name, an activist from Brazil. We like him. He generally liked the theme of the book. And I said a message that Sarkar, the founder of the progressive utilization theory, or Prout, said during his visit in 1979. He said, Venezuela needs good spiritual political leaders. He said if Venezuelan can produce good spiritual leaders, then it will be not only the leader of Latin America, but the leader of the world. Venezuela is a blessed country. Now, I should tell you, Dave, he said similar things about every country, okay? He had the potential of every country, he inspired the people. But for those of us in Venezuela, that's an inspiring message.
It is indeed.
So I mentioned this on television, and then President Chavez said, "Welcome, brother, and let's continue with spirituality, spirit, good faith, morality, and the mystical force that guides the world."
Those were his words.
Those were his very words. Yes. Translation, okay. Mm-hmm. But those were the very words in Spanish. Mm-hmm. And I thought I liked that. You know, I believe there is a mystical force that guides the world. Chavez once in a different interview, he clarified there's differences between him and Fidel Castro, for example. He said, first of all, we're friends, okay? But he says we have three differences. One is that President Castro, Fidel Castro at that time, is an atheist, and I'm not. I believe in Christ both as a personal redeemer and as a social liberator. Second, he said, he's a communist. They have a one-party system. We believe in free and fair elections. We have a multi-party system. And finally, he said, they have a state-owned, concentrated, state-controlled, centralized economy, excuse me. And we have a mixed economy. We have small private enterprises. We have worker-managed enterprises and state-owned enterprises, like the petroleum company is state-owned. And Chavez has nationalized many of the essential strategic key industries like telecommunications, electricity, water, the utilities, aluminum, steel, many. So anyway, like that, he said, but we're still friends. And he was until his death. Today there's President Maduro, who is trying to follow the same principles. I can say one last thing. There are two major problems in Venezuela today. One is kind of a double problem. It's inefficiency and corruption. It's an old problem that's historic throughout Latin America, even in the United States, where I come from, there's corruption, okay? But it's a serious problem in Venezuela. And the second one is crime. When poverty is going down, it's gone down significantly. Poverty, since Chavez came to power, has gone down 50%, and absolute poverty is down 70%. So that's a significant drop and significant improvement in the lives of the common people. And yet, crime has not gone down. And why? There's at least 10 reasons that are interrelated, okay? Complicated. The prisons, the police force. One problem is the United States. The people in the United States have this tremendous desire. They'll pay any price for this funny white powder that comes from Colombia. And because Colombia has this long, long jungle border with Venezuela, it's impossible to adequately police that border and stop some of the... And the money is so lucrative, making millions and millions of dollars in profits because of the demand of the United States, you know, consumers, that they can bribe an official here, you know, a military man there, and they can, you know, some of it comes through Venezuela on its way to the United States. So like that, there's a number of problems that cause crime to continue, and impunity. But these are the two major problems that the government somehow has to face in order to win the sympathy of the middle class back to their government. Yeah.
So tell me more about your specific project.
Right, so in 2006 I went there to permanently open the Prout Research Institute of Venezuela, which was registered in 2007. We support cooperatives. We teach the progressive utilization theory, which is an alternative model, a post-capitalist model. We teach lifestyle about yoga and meditation as a, you know, for personal health and integrity. And ethics and environmental protection is fundamental to Prout. So we do consciousness raising. My recent book, which is called After Capitalism, the same first title, Economic Democracy in Action, came out 2 years ago in English, and now it's been published in Spanish and the as well as Korean and Portuguese. The largest publisher, government publishing house in Venezuela called Monte Avila is publishing it this year, but it's already been published in Puerto Rico. And so with this book I give talks, lectures, I speak to universities and schools. We also get volunteers. We've had over 50 international volunteers since we started from many, many countries in the world.
So your volunteers receive training as well as they can provide service?
Right, right. They pay for their air ticket to come if they're approved, and we provide their housing and their food and their basic necessities, water and Caracas.
Wow. Sounds like a great thing to do.
Right. We have a sister project and we work together. The sister project is what we call a master unit. It's a rural integrated farm that does social service projects and also integrated holistic organic farming. That farm, Centro Madre, 2 hours from Caracas by car, in the district of Barlovento in the state of Miranda, to the east of Caracas. Centro Madre is now recognized by the national government and the local government as a national model of small-scale sustainable agriculture. They get students from the university agriculture students, postgraduate students. They get more than 100 visitors a week. Cars are stopping in every 5 or 10 minutes. Local farmers asking for advice. Local school classes come sometimes to get an experience. The whole farm is only 3.5 hectares. That's, 8 acres. That's not very big. It's very small.
The thing is, you know, we don't have enough space on the planet. And if you can do such great work in 3.5 hectares,
right,
it's a good sign.
They're producing when they have rain. Sometimes they don't, right now they don't have enough rain. But when they have adequate rain, 30 to 40 tons of guavas every year from the guava trees. Plus, they produce guava seedlings in the nursery and they sell these seedlings. They've sold over 90,000 seedlings to local farmers in the state of Miranda.
Not bad.
Yes, and they're diversifying, but the guavas were especially useful because sometimes they suffer flooding in that region and some of the other fruit trees die, but this type of guava tree is very resilient to flooding.
Is that a cash crop in itself? Can it be,
sure,
you know, for raising funds for the local community?
It sure raises funds for Centro Madre, and yes. Mm-hmm. They also grow papaya, they also grow bananas and plantain, they also grow yuca, vegetables, papaya. They do medicinal plants, neem, and drumstick is called. Sorry, I don't remember the proper name.
Yeah. It's a nice one for vegetables.
Yes,
isn't it?
Well, it's a good one for medicine. It has very high nutrients. But anyway, it's a very effective farm. They have fish farm. They have the nursery. They have the worms that are producing humus that is great for cultivation. It's organic. It's inspiring.
Wonderful.
So that's an example of agriculture as well as social service projects for the impoverished villagers near there. They're showing example how to earn cash. They have a community store that just opened, so now they're starting to sell the products, the handicrafts and cultivated products, cakes and other things like that from the local villagers to the tourists that pass by on the main highway, which is where the farm is located. So it's an ideal community store.
Well, I'm very tempted to just quit my job and
come on down. We invite applications. Mm-hmm. Our website is www.priven.org. .ve for Venezuela. And yes, we invite people to visit our webpage or just check Venezuela Prout and you'll find us. We invite people to come down and experience what a social transformation is taking place in the whole country and how we can actually participate, how we can actually be a part of the change that we want to see.
Yes, and you can be part of something that can be duplicated in other parts of the world.
Exactly.
So it's really the future.
All the research that we do, for example, is on our webpage, is under resources section. You can download anything. We want to make a model that's replicable. That's been our dream since the beginning.
Fantastic. Well, that's enough for to inspire me, hopefully the viewers as well. So thank you for watching. My name is Div and this has been Dada Maheshvarananda. I hope you get in touch with him and find out more. So thank you for watching. Goodbye.
Thank you.